good to know that people like you join us to see our online Sunday service here at Ridgeway Community Church, Redditch. Well, today we have Andrew and Vivian Birch from the European Mission Fellowship. Andrew will be sharing a little bit about that work and also preaching from God's Word today. It's lovely that folks join in with the prayers and the songs of praise, as well as to listen to God's Word read and proclaimed. So let's rejoice together as we sing this lovely hymn of praise to our God and our Saviour. Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you for watching over us throughout these past days. Thank you for your help in all things pertaining to our walk with Jesus and our living in this world. And we pray this morning, as we have come aside, that you would graciously refresh us and grant once more that our focus will be upon you, our Lord and our God, our Saviour. How we thank you for Jesus, your only begotten Son. How we thank you for the faith that you plant in the hearts of men and women such as ourselves, undeserving and yet rejoicing in your goodness and your grace. Oh Lord, will you draw close to each one of us this morning here And Lord, also to those, Lord, who have not been able to come this morning for various reasons. You know them, and you know their circumstances. You know the things that weigh upon their minds, that trouble them, that hinder them perhaps. Heavenly Father, will you, by your Spirit, just draw them near to yourself also. And those others, Lord, who are not known to us, who watch online at a later date, will you bless them just as if they were here with us, so to speak, that the reality of your presence will be so for them too, and that they, along with us, will hear your voice, hear you speaking to us through the word. And grant indeed this morning that as we hear your word, read and proclaim, that we would take it to heart and respond to it. We thank you that there are many, many, many people throughout our world who at some point in this period of time today will be gathering to lift up Jesus Christ in their songs of praises and their prayers and in their proclamation. Grant, Father, today that there will be those who will be added to the church because of your grace on the basis of the finished work of Jesus our Saviour. Oh, help us all to look to him once more this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing "I Stand Amazed in the Presence," and then Andrew and Vivian are going to come and make their presentation. Thank you.
How wonderful is my Savior.
Well, it's great to be with you today. So thank you for your welcome. And Vivian and I really appreciate the opportunity to be with you today. It's our first time in this part of the world. And what better place than to be with the Lord's people as they meet together to worship Him. So let me just tell you a bit about myself, not because I like talking about myself, I don't, but Bill suggested it might be interesting for me to tell you how I came to faith. So it's going to be a very short version of a long story, but I was born in Northampton. I suppose that's about an hour and a half drive from here. And then when I was 4 years old, we as a family moved to a village not far from Northampton called Moulton. For those of you that may have heard of the famous missionary William Carey, who went to India in 1792, he spent several years living and working in the village of Moulton. He was a shoe repairer, school teacher, pastor, all wrapped in one. And it was there that he got his vision for mission all over the world. And he had this leather globe that he used to pray over day after day for the different countries of the world before he went out to India himself as a missionary. I'm only saying that because it just happens to be the coincidence that William Carey lived in Moulton for a few years, and 200 years later I lived in Moulton for a few years. I'm not claiming to be anything like William Carey, by the way, but we as a family used to go to church, to a church in the town of Northampton. And in those days, like a lot of people, I just thought that everybody was a Christian. I assumed that all the people I knew, all the people around me were Christians, that this was a Christian country. We were all Christians, weren't we? But then I started to read the Bible. I can't remember exactly when or why I started to read the Bible, but I was very young at the time. I must have been, I don't know, 8 or 9 years old. Now I look back and can say that God gave me the desire and the idea to take up and read the Bible. And once I started, there was no stopping me. I just would read the Bible as a young boy. Every night when I went to bed, I would get out my Bible, read the Bible. I would read through the Bible again and again and again, year after year, through those years growing up. And that was how I became a Christian, just through reading the Bible. For several years, again, I thought I was already a Christian. I went to church on Sundays. I went to Sunday school. I said my prayers. I was reading the Bible. Surely I must be a Christian. But as I read the Bible, I began to realize that you didn't just drift into being a Christian. You either were or you weren't. And I hadn't yet become a Christian. At the age of 11, was when I finally realized that I wasn't yet a Christian. I needed to become a Christian. And that was when I prayed to God to make me a Christian at the age of 11. And I put my trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal savior at that time. And it was only a year or two after that, so I was still quite young, when I first began to feel that God might be calling me to become, I don't know, a pastor or maybe a missionary or maybe something else like that. And that sense of God calling me stayed with me all through the following year. So I was at school, then I went off to university. Throughout that time, I never lost that sense that God was in some way calling me into some kind of, let's call it, Christian work or Christian ministry. And I went to Nottingham University, and that was where I met Vivian, who's now my wife. We actually met at the Christian Union. We were both already Christians when we went to university, and we met at a meeting of the Christian Union and started to get to know each other. And it was actually Vivian who first introduced me to EMF, that we'll be speaking more about in a moment, European Mission Fellowship. I had never heard of EMF before I met Vivian, and she was the one that was enthusiastically telling me about this wonderful missionary organization. She'd actually heard some of the missionaries from different countries speaking to her youth group over many years, so she was very familiar with EMF. I'd never heard of it. She introduced me to it. And to cut a very long story short, we've now been serving with EMF for 40 years. In fact, this year we celebrate 40 years serving with EMF. So we were in Spain as EMF missionaries for 37 years, from 1983 until 2020. And then for the last 3 years, We've been working with the EMF home team, let's call them, here in this country. So we've got three grown-up children, very grown-up children, and they're all living in Spain, and we have six Spanish grandchildren. So I wonder how much you all know about this organization called EMF. So Vivian's going to help us by clicking through the slides on the screen, and I'm just going to share with you 10 quick questions and answers about EMF. You may already know some of the answers to some of the questions, but anyway, I'll assume that maybe some of you might not know so much about EMF. So here are just 10 very simple questions and answers about EMF. So firstly, what does EMF stand for? I mean, I've already said it. It's European Mission Fellowship. Just to confuse you, we used to be called European Missionary Fellowship. About 10 years or so ago, the name was changed, that subtle change from European Missionary Fellowship to European Mission Fellowship. I wasn't around at the time to know why that change was made, but I think it was to put the emphasis on the mission rather than on the missionaries themselves. But anyway, it's still EMF. It's still the same organization. We're still doing the same things that we were doing before that change came about in our name. Secondly, why is it called that? Why are we called European Mission Fellowship? And the simple answer is because we are a fellowship of Christians supporting mission in Europe. So that's an obvious explanation as to why EMF, why European Mission Fellowship. We're a fellowship or a group, a family of Christians supporting mission in different places all over Europe. Question number three, why Europe? And the simple answer to that question is because Europe right now is the neediest continent in the world from a spiritual point of view. And that may come as a bit of a surprise to some of you, I don't know. We don't tend to think of Europe as being the neediest part of the world in terms of the gospel and spiritually speaking, and yet that is the reality. Europe is the most atheistic continent. There's lots of religion in Europe, but there's not much actual Bible-believing Christianity or gospel Christianity. So Europe today is, in many ways, the spiritually neediest continent in the world. If I can give you two examples to help you understand this. If we compare, say, Europe with one country in Africa, which is Nigeria, admittedly, it's the most populous country in Africa, but even so. So there are 3.5 times as many people in Europe as there are in Nigeria. 3.5 times as many people in Europe as there are in Nigeria. And yet, there are more Bible-believing Christians in Nigeria than in the whole of Europe. Do you understand what I'm saying? In terms of Bible-believing or born-again Christians, there are more of those in Nigeria alone, just one African country, than in the whole of Europe. So that gives you an idea, even though there are 3.5 times as many people in Europe as there are in Nigeria. Another comparison with China. Obviously, China is a very difficult country for Christians because they get persecuted, especially in some particular parts of the country. But again, there are, let me get this right, twice as many people in China as there are in Europe. Okay, twice as many people in China as in Europe. And yet there are 5 times as many Bible-believing Christians in China as there are in the whole of Europe. Just in one Asian country, okay, a big country, China. But China only has twice as many people as Europe, but it has 5 times as many born-again Christians as the whole of Europe. So do you see why I'm just giving you 2 examples, but do you see why I'm saying that Europe is a really needy continent in terms of spirituality and the gospel and what people actually believe? There's lots of gospel-less Christianity in Europe, religion, if you like, lots of religion in Europe still, but there aren't that many actual Bible-believing, Bible-teaching churches and Christians. So question number 4, when was EMF born? And the answer is in 1959, in other words, 64 years ago this year. Question number 5, what does EMF do? Well, EMF essentially we help churches. That's the way I like to say it, because we think that churches are really important in God's plan to save people. God chooses to use churches like your church and other local churches, whether bigger or smaller. God uses churches to make known the gospel, the message about Jesus, to other people. And so we see our role, EMF, as being to help and support churches as they do that. So we help churches to fulfill the Great Commission, or the church's great mission, to tell people about Jesus, make disciples, followers of Jesus, nurture those disciples in their faith, start new churches where there aren't churches, and so on. That's how we see our role as a missionary organization. Question number six, how do we do that? Well, we do that basically by connecting churches here in this country with other similar churches in other parts of Europe. So we build relationships or partnerships between churches here in the UK and churches in other European countries, so that those churches can pray together and work together to get the gospel to as many people as possible in those different places. Question number seven, what's different about EMF? And the answer is, most of the missionaries that we support are from the countries where they're serving. Now, do you see why I'm saying that? We perhaps have in our minds this idea of missionaries being Christians from this country or from America or from other countries in the Northern Hemisphere going to needy parts of the world with the gospel. That's our kind of idea of missionaries. But most of the missionaries that we're supporting are actually people working in their own countries where they were born and brought up. But they're working either as pastors or evangelists or church planters, or they're publishing Christian books, or they're involved in training pastors. So the missionaries we're supporting are more often than not people working in their own countries, but with the help of our organization of EMF. So just to give you a few examples, we're supporting quite a few missionaries in Poland, and they're all Polish. And all the missionaries we're supporting in Romania are Romanians. And in Ukraine, they're all Ukrainian. So that's not a hard and fast rule. Vivian and I went from the UK to Spain as EMF missionaries, and there are other EMF missionaries today that are not from the countries where they're serving, but most of them, more than 80% of the people we're helping, are people working in their own countries. Now, do you see why that, in a sense, is a good idea? It's because they don't need to learn their language, they already speak it, they already know their country, they already know the culture, they already know the main religions in their countries, and so they've got a lot of advantages over people going from other countries to those countries. So that's one of the reasons why we like to support people from their own countries serving as pastors and evangelizing and planting new churches in their own countries where we can do that. That's our main way of working. Question number eight, only three to go. How many churches are we helping at the moment? Well, we're helping around 50 churches. May not sound like very many, but we are helping around 50 churches in different European countries. Question number nine, how many countries are we working in at the moment? The answer is 18. We're working in the 18 countries that I hope will come up on the screen, which I've had so much faith in that I haven't looked at it once so far. But they're the 18 countries you can see there on the left where we're supporting churches and missionaries, gospel work at the present time in those 18 countries. But obviously that's only roughly a third of all the countries in Europe. In Europe there are around 50 countries, so 18 doesn't sound like many, and we would love to be able to support work in countries where we're not working at the moment. Some of those countries we've started working in very recently, for example Bulgaria and Denmark are two countries where until January of this year we had never supported any gospel work before, and now we are doing that in those two countries, Bulgaria and Denmark. And so we are gradually getting involved in work in different countries that we haven't worked in before, but at the minute it's 18 countries that we're working in. Question number 10 and the last question, what else does EMF do? Well, we also support training and publishing, two very important things when you think about it, because if we want the gospel to reach more people, then that requires more missionaries or pastors or evangelist gospel workers. But people need to get training in order to be able to do that work. So we not only get involved in supporting them doing the work, but before that, we help them to get the training they need. So we're supporting at the moment six students Four of them, three of them are from Portugal, one from Spain and two from Italy. And they're the six students we're supporting as they study at different Bible colleges and seminaries in different countries. And we're helping people like that get the training they need so that when they finish that training, they can start working as church planters or evangelists or pastors or whatever. And then publishing, because obviously in countries where there are not many Bible-believing churches and Christians, books can often reach people that people can't reach. So we're supporting publishing, especially in Polish and in Spanish, but also in Hungarian. And during this war in Ukraine, we've been supporting publishing in both Ukrainian and Russian. So where we can, we support Christians who are publishing good books in their own languages, and we're helping them to be able to do that. So hopefully this gives you an idea, at least, of what EMF is and does. So let me just bring you up to date as I finish this report with what's happening at EMF, or what's been happening in recent weeks and months. First of all, we have what we're calling an expanded vision for Europe, which basically means that we're asking God to enable us to do more work than we've been doing in the past. We see the need is very great, the situation is urgent. There are so many towns and villages all over Europe where there is no Bible-believing church. And so we really feel that we need to be doing more than we're doing. And so we've had this expanded vision, which means that we want to reach into the darkness of Europe by supporting more missionaries, more pastors, more church planters, as many as we can all over Europe. And our aim, again, it may not sound like a very ambitious aim, but we aim to support, to take on 15 new missionaries or missionary couples in 5 years. That may not sound like very much, three a year for 5 years, 15 new couples. But for us, it would mean increasing our missionaries by over 30% in just 5 years. And we're asking the Lord to help us to be able to do that and to take on these new workers. And on the screen, you can see our five latest or newest EMF missionaries. And I know that Eva and Fiona were here just a couple of weeks ago. So they're one of our newest missionary couples who haven't yet been able to relocate to central Spain. But on the left, we've got Tobias and Julie from Aarhus or Aarhus in Denmark. In the middle at the top, Rafael and Lidiane and their children in the south of Portugal in the Algarve. In a place called Portimão. They're planting a church there. Then Eva and Fiona that you know about. On the bottom left, Paulo and Patricia are doing a church plant in Coimbra, the fourth largest city in Portugal. And then Ilia and Cristina are in a place called Ruse in the north of Bulgaria, near the Romanian border. And they're planting a church in a town of 160,000 people in the north of Bulgaria. So these are our newest missionaries. All of them have started working as missionaries with EMF this year, 2023. Eva and Fiona, as I say, haven't yet reached the mission field. And Paulo and Patricia are just starting right now as EMF missionaries in that church plant in Coimbra in Portugal. So these are some of our newest missionaries. And the encouraging thing for me, at least, is that of those five couples, four of them are involved in planting new churches. In other words, they're not just taking the baton from their predecessors in already existing churches, but they're starting churches from zero in places where before there were no evangelical or Bible-believing churches. And that's the way that we want to go as a mission. We want to support as many new church plants as we can in different parts of Europe where they're desperately needed. Now let me finish by saying a bit about Ukraine. As you probably know, EMF, we've been trying to support people in Ukraine right since the war started on the 24th of February last year. Only a few days after that date, we launched our first Ukraine emergency appeal. I was explaining to Bill before the service that our initial target at the time in terms of finance was £50,000. You know, we're a relatively small organization. For us, £50,000 is a lot of money. And so we were asking the Lord to enable us to help with £50,000, the people of Ukraine. £50,000 came in under 1 week. And after that, the money kept coming in from so many churches and families and individuals, not only all over the UK, but even in other parts of the world. We've had several hundred thousand pounds sent to us from America and other places in other parts of the world. And we've now received about £1.5 million during these last 14 months. And all of that money is being used not only to help to meet people's physical needs in a time of war, like food, clothing, medication, hygiene products, electricity generators, all the things that we know people in Ukraine have needed over these last 14 months. We've been helping them with all of those things. We've been sending lorry loads of stuff from Poland and the Netherlands into Ukraine when that was the best way of doing it. Otherwise, we send money to people in Ukraine when they can buy the things on the ground in Ukraine itself. But apart from the humanitarian aspect, we've been encouraged and excited to see how the churches have been reaching out with the gospel to people during this time of war. We had the privilege of going to Ukraine, Vivian and I, with one of our colleagues just a few weeks ago. So we were in Ukraine in April, a month ago, and we spent about 8 days visiting churches. We were invited by two local councils, and they invited us into the town hall, and they treated us like royalty just because they knew that our organization had been helping the people of Ukraine. And you know, they were saying things to us like, you know, please convey our thanks to the British government. And we were thinking, well, you know, we don't have regular contact with the Prime Minister, but we'll do what we can. And to the British people for their support of us during this terrible time of war. So, you know, so many people, every time we walked into a place, people were hugging us and kissing us and thanking us and applauding us and so on, which was really embarrassing because we didn't feel as though we'd done very much at all. And they were just thanking us for being there, for going to Ukraine. And, you know, they said, oh, you're very brave. We said, no, you're the brave ones. We come and we go out again in a week's time, but you have to live in this situation, a terrible situation. But we were so excited. I preached in two churches on a Sunday, three Sundays ago, in Kyiv, the capital of Ukraine. And, you know, both churches were absolutely packed with people. I mean, we were sitting in this pew, you know, without sort of any breathing space. And there were people standing in the aisles and people. And then afterwards, they were telling us, you know what, most of these people are not yet Christians, but they've started coming to the church for the humanitarian aid. And then they've heard the gospel. They've kept coming. Even though they don't need any more, you know, food or help in that kind, but they're still coming to church. They told us that more than half the people attending churches at the moment in Ukraine are not yet Christians, but they're people that are open to the gospel. And we're hearing of many people coming to faith, many people being baptized and added to the churches, even as they have the sirens going off. We were in a place called Ternopil in the west of Ukraine. It's the only time that the warning sirens went off when we were actually there. And we were in this city council, and they ushered us down to the basement very discreetly, just carrying on the conversation. And we realized it was because the sirens were sounding, which normally mean that a missile could land at any time in that particular place. It didn't happen, obviously, but the people were just so grateful. And we visited lots of churches, and they've been helping so many thousands of people. We were in one church in a place called Irpin, not far from Kyiv, which is where the Russian soldiers got. And they were on the verge of going into the city of Kyiv. And then this bridge was blown up by the Ukrainian soldiers. You may remember this from the news. And then the Russian tanks couldn't get any further in towards Kyiv. And we were at a church right there beside that, where that bridge is, where the Russian tanks arrived. And this church was suddenly found itself in a situation where they were feeding 500 people every day. Feeding 500 people. And they just let people sleep in any available space in the church premises. So there were all these sleeping bags, you know, in the kitchen, in the bathrooms, on the stairs, in all the available spaces. There were literally hundreds of people. And that's just one church. But we heard the same story from church after church of how in the early weeks of the war, that had all these refugees coming in, internally displaced people. And the churches were really doing what the authorities weren't able to do. Nobody else was able to do this, but the evangelical churches were at the forefront of helping the people in so many different parts of Ukraine, both in the east of Ukraine and in other parts of the country. So we've just tried in our small way. We already were supporting two missionary families in Ukraine, and through them, we asked them to introduce us to other people that they knew they could trust in other parts of the country. So they started to put us in touch with other churches, other pastors, other people, and gradually we built up a network. We were soon helping over 150 churches all over Ukraine through this networking of contacts between people that knew people and so on. So that's what we've been trying to do. We launched an appeal at Christmas called Bibles and Blankets for Ukraine. And again, we had a very humble expectation, because it's on top of all the other money that had already been given. We thought, well, how can we ask people to give more money at Christmas when they've already given so sacrificially all through the year? But again, we were expecting, or hoping and praying, for maybe £25,000 in response to this Christmas appeal. And we had £150,000 sent on top of what had already been received during the previous month. So we're so grateful to all the churches and individuals. We're thankful to you as a church for the gifts that you have contributed towards our help of the people of Ukraine. So let's just show you, as I close this part, three videos. There are only 1 minute videos, giving the impressions of Vivian and myself and the other brother Martin, the three of us that went to Ukraine just a few weeks ago. We were there in Ukraine, and these are some of our impressions of this trip that we had in Ukraine, as I close. Let's just watch these three videos.
I recently had the privilege of preaching at two churches in Kyiv in Ukraine. Both churches were packed, and we were told that a lot of those present were not yet believers. And we're hearing the same story from all over Ukraine. Thousands of non-Christians affected by the war are being helped by evangelical churches and are hearing the gospel, and some of them coming to faith. But sadly, at this time of great opportunity, there are fewer pastors than before. Many have left the country. Some are serving in the army, and some have been killed. We met the principal of Kyiv Theological Seminary, and he told us how the war is affecting the training of future church leaders. So pray with us for more gospel workers for Ukraine. Pray for the churches in Ukraine to make the most of the opportunities, and pray that the Lord will make this war a time of salvation.
Oksana Kostyshyn is married to Volodya, a key figure in making sure EMF appeal funds arrive safely to trusted individuals and churches all over Ukraine. Oksana's borne extra burden since the war began, for with Volodya busier than ever in his pastoral work, she's often alone looking after lively little Alexei and giving 24/7 care to disabled Zechariah. Luda Mariash and EMF missionary husband Vitaly spent the first weeks of the war ministering to other displaced persons far away from their work in Kyiv Theological Seminary. But since then, with Vitaly serving on the Eastern Front in the military, Luda's been a lone parent of two children, tirelessly coordinating the relief work in the Bible and Life Church in Kyiv, and is active in outreach while still working part-time. We can praise God for such women who are playing a vital part in wartime Christian ministry. Please pray for the Kostyshyn family, who are exhausted, and for the Mariash family, with Vitaly in constant danger and the others serving faithfully back in Kyiv. Thank you.
If there was one scene which will remain long in my memory, it would be of Pastor Basil Ostry standing on the edge of the destroyed bridge across the Irpin River, which the Ukrainians have blown up to stop the Russians advancing into Kyiv. Within days of the Russian attack, the Irpin Bible Church organized help and shelter to get people to safety across the river. But those very places like Borodyanka, which became synonymous with Russian brutality, are now the very places where the Irpin Bible Church has set up six church plants. It was such a joy to join with the 30 or so people who met together in the room in Hostomel, many people from an Orthodox background, as they held a simple church service of songs and prayers and hearing the Bible explained. So please pray for these six church plants around Irpin. Pray for the great need of pastors and leaders, and pray for the many other churches being planted across Ukraine.
So let's pray for more workers, more gospel workers for Europe, such a needy continent. Let's pray that the gospel will reach and have an impact on the lives of many thousands more people all over Europe. Let's pray for new churches to be started where there are no Bible-believing churches, which is many, many places all over our continent. And let's pray together too for an end to this terrible war in Ukraine. Thank you.
Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, what a great need has been presented to us this morning. We thank you for the establishing of the European Mission Fellowship all those years ago. We thank you for your call upon Andrew and Vivian's life and bringing them to this present place. And Father, we pray that some of those countries, Lord, where there is such a dearth of Bible-believing churches and believers in Jesus, we pray, Lord, that in those 50 countries that you would grant, Lord, the vision that European Mission Fellowship have to enlarge and develop the work, to do even more than 15 new missionaries in 5 years. Father, have you not provided even more than was their expectation in the needs that arose in Ukraine? Father, we pray that you would send in laborers into the harvest field. We thank you, Lord, for those that are being raised up. We thank you, Lord, for these five new missionary couples and our privilege in being introduced to Evaia and Fiona going out to Spain. Father, we pray for the work in Denmark, the work in Bulgaria and Portugal. These new plants, Lord, it rejoices our hearts to know that there are those going to serve, Lord, not riding, as it were, off the back of something existing, but starting in fresh ground. And we pray, Lord, you would go before these couples and grant that as they sow the seed of the word, that you would add to your church many young people, children, men and women, we pray. Oh, Lord, will you build your church in Europe? We thank you, Lord, for the 18 countries in which, Lord, the work already begins. And yet even there, Lord, there is so much need. It seems as if to us that the labourers are few. And you invite us to join together and lift up our voice and ask that you would send in labourers into those harvest fields. Will you raise them up, nationals in their own land, understanding their own culture, speaking their own languages. Father, we pray that a great work will be done in the days that lie ahead, that the need will be met. We thank you, Lord, for the publishing work that goes on. We thank you, Lord, for the training work that goes on. And we pray, Lord, that those books and literature which might, Lord, otherwise, Lord, they would find their way then into the hands of those who do not know you, that they would be reached by those books where perhaps they would not otherwise have been reached by an individual, whether in Hungarian or Spanish, Ukrainian, Russian, Bulgarian, whatever it is. And we thank you, Lord, for that ongoing work. We thank you for the training of folks to, Lord, serve you in church planting and in church work. And we pray, Lord, especially for Evaia and Fiona, that you would open the way according to the need, Lord, as they plan to go to Spain in the autumn. Provide accommodation for them. Help them, Lord, to settle into the culture. And help Fiona especially with language learning. Grant that they may feel the strength of your support, Lord, underneath them. Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. What need, what trauma, what challenges, and yet what opportunities, of which we have heard some this morning. Father, we thank you for those, Lord, who are so courageous, making such sacrifice, facing danger, long and difficult journeys, arduous tasks, and so feeling a great weariness and exhaustion in all that they seek to do. But we thank you for their zeal. We thank you, Lord, for the inspiration of their sacrificial service. We thank you for the many that are being reached as a result, Lord, of their labours in the gospel. How amazing to us. In a war-torn zone of Irpin, 6 new churches planted. Father, will you bless the work of the gospel in that country of Ukraine? Father, will you cause that there will be an even greater impact of the witness of your people to the Lord Jesus Christ? And Father, we pray that in your mercy and with great power that you would bring an end to this dreadful conflict causing so much pain and hurt and loss, we ask. And we thank you then. Thank you for your church worldwide. Oh Lord, will you in these days grant an increase to the churches across Europe, and we include our own land, here in England, here in Redditch. Lord, there is no heart so hard that you cannot break it and melt it and mould it and transform it. There is no one so far that you cannot stretch out your arm to save them. There is no one so cold that you cannot cause a fire of heavenly love to burn in their hearts. And will you grant us, all of us, Lord, the vision, the burden, to reach out. And oh Lord, in your goodness, grant to us the joy of seeing a harvest reaped, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So for our Bible reading, can we turn to John's Gospel chapter 4, the famous passage about Jesus and the Samaritan woman. And we'll just read part of this story and then we'll sing and then we'll think about this passage together. So John chapter 4, and we're going to read first of all verses 1 to 4 and then I'll tell you where we're going to jump to after that. John chapter 4 verses 1 to 4. And we read, "Therefore when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee, but he needed to go through Samaria." And now we'll jump to verse 7 and read 7 to 14. 7 to 14. "A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink,' for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, 'How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans.' Jesus answered and said to her, 'If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, "Give me a drink," you would have asked him and he would have given you living water.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself as well as his sons and his livestock?' Jesus answered and said to her, 'Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life.'" Now we'll jump to verse 16, 16 to 18. "Jesus said to her, 'Go call your husband and come here.' The woman answered and said, 'I have no husband.' Jesus said to her, 'You have well said, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke truly.'" And now finally we'll jump to 25 and 26. "The woman said to him, 'I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things.' Jesus said to her, 'I who speak to you am he.'" So let's sing our next hymn, "I Serve a Risen Saviour," or "He Lives," as we also know it as. Let's stand and sing together.
I'm
So although I hope this has already become clear in what I was saying about the work of EMF, what is the church's main mission? And if we are Christians, what is our main mission? Let me summarize in just a few words what I understand our main mission is. It is to tell people about Jesus. To tell people about Jesus. That's how I understand, in simple words, what our mission and the church's mission is. We are to evangelize, which means we're to tell people the good news. We would say the great news about Jesus. But how do we do that? And my simple answer today is that we need to evangelize like the Master, like the Lord Jesus himself. In other words, we need to learn from the way he evangelized. He is the Master for at least two reasons. Firstly, because if we're Christians, he is our Lord and Master. But secondly, he's the Master because he's the Master Evangelist. He's the greatest evangelist of all. And we see that throughout the four Gospels, don't we? And we see it here in John chapter 4, where we see Jesus evangelizing the Samaritan woman. So how did he do that? How did Jesus evangelize her or share the gospel with her? If we can answer that question, we'll be able to answer the question, how should we evangelize people today? So let me draw out of this meeting between Jesus and the Samaritan woman 10 principles or lessons that we need to learn from how the Master evangelized on that occasion. Firstly, we need to love people. This is the first thing that we need to do in order to share the gospel with others. We need to love people, really to love them. It'd be easy to miss this in this story, but this wonderful story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman begins with Jesus's love for her, for the Samaritan woman. Jesus was going, we read, from Judea to Galilee, verses 1 to 3. In other words, he was going from the south of Israel, Judea, to the north of Israel, Galilee. And John tells us in verse 4 that Jesus needed to go through Samaria. And if you were to look at a map of Israel at that time, maybe you've got maps at the end of your Bibles, if you're using a Bible in paper form, you would see straight away that what John says here makes perfect sense. Samaria was in the middle of Israel, between Judea in the south and Galilee up in the north. So yes, obviously Jesus, to go from Judea in the south to Galilee in the north, had to pass through Samaria in the middle. But John's phrase that Jesus needed to go through Samaria is much more than just an explanation of the geography of Israel. Apart from the geography, Jesus needed to go through Samaria because it was his intention to go to that town of Sychar in Samaria to talk to one particular person, the Samaritan woman, in order to save her. The phrase he needed to go through Samaria is literally, it was necessary for him to go through Samaria. But it wasn't just a geographical necessity, it was a missional necessity, because Jesus was on a mission to evangelize and save that Samaritan woman. That's why I said that this story begins with Jesus' love for the Samaritan woman. And we need to love people, don't we, if we're to help them by sharing the gospel with them. The more we love people, the more we'll pray for them. And the more we'll look for opportunities to share the great news about Jesus with them. One of the main problems in our evangelism is surely, if we're honest, that we don't love people as much as we should. And if we love them more, then spontaneously we would do more to try to help them spiritually and share the gospel with them. So that's the first thing we learn from the Master in this passage. We need to love people. Then secondly, we need to go to people. That was what Jesus did, if you think about it. When he set off on that journey from Judea in the south, going northwards, he was going to evangelize that particular woman, the Samaritan woman. That was his plan all along, to share the gospel with her in order that she might be saved. So Jesus went to Samaria And then when he was in Samaria, he went to one particular town or village, the town of Sychar. And when he was in Sychar, he went to a particular place on the outskirts of the town where the well was that people used to get their water from. In other words, Jesus went to where he knew the Samaritan woman would be. But what do? In our evangelism, well, sadly, too often we wait for people to come to us. We hope that people will turn up on Sunday. We hope that some outsider will just decide after breakfast, oh, I think I'm going to go to church today. I'll go to that church down the road. But the great mission of the church isn't to wait for people to come to us so that then we can share the gospel with them. The great mission of the church is for us to go to them where they are. We are the ones that are responsible to get the gospel to where they are. We need to learn from Jesus. He went to Samaria, went to Sychar, went to the well, and then talked to the woman and shared the gospel with her. And that is a pattern for what we also are to do. We are to take the gospel to people where they are. Where they are. You may have heard the idea that before Christ came, mission was centripetal, in other words, from the rest of the world to Jerusalem. But after Christ, the mission of the church became centrifugal, in other words, starting in Jerusalem and then going out all over the world from there. There was a huge change after the death and resurrection of Christ in the way mission was going to be done. And because Jesus loved the Samaritan woman, he went to her where she was. And if we love people, then as hard as it sometimes is, we will go to people where they are in order to share the gospel with them. So we need to love people. We need to go to where they are. We need to overcome barriers, number three. Between the Samaritan woman and Jesus, there were at least three obvious barriers in the way. Firstly, she was a woman. And I say that because in those days, it wasn't so easy as it is today for men and women who weren't married to have conversations together. So that was a barrier. That's one of the reasons why she said to Jesus, how is it that you speak to me? It wasn't just because she was a Samaritan, but it was also because she was a woman. And when the disciples got back, they were surprised to find Jesus talking to a woman, because it wasn't the done thing. It wasn't normal in those days and in that culture. So that was one barrier. She was a woman. Secondly, she was a Samaritan, and Jews and Samaritans weren't talking to each other. They had no relationship. They were like enemies, rivals. But then thirdly, there was a barrier of the woman's way of life. She was an immoral Samaritan woman. She'd been married 5 times already, and now she was living with a man who wasn't her husband. In other words, we're reading about a sexually immoral lifestyle, and that could easily have been another barrier between Jesus and her. And we read about these barriers in this passage. But Jesus swept aside all those barriers. He didn't mind that she was a woman and a Samaritan and living an immoral life, because out of love for her, a sinner, it was his intention to introduce himself to her so that she might come to faith in him and experience the wonderful gift of living water or salvation. Do you see how Jesus swept aside all those conventions and barriers in order to speak to her and share the gospel with her? Yes, in some ways our situation is different. In our culture, men and women can talk to each other more easily. We don't come across too many Samaritans today. We don't even come across too many Jews more often than not. But on the other hand, more and more people's lives these days are just as messy as the Samaritan woman's life in that situation. But there are always barriers to the gospel, aren't there? There are language barriers. When we're crossing boundaries between countries and we don't speak the language, we have to learn the language in order to be able to share the gospel with someone who speaks that language. There are barriers of other religions, Islam, Hinduism, or whatever it happens to be. There is the barrier of gospel-less churchianity. Churches that call themselves churches, but you will never hear the gospel being explained in those churches. What a tragedy. Churches exist to make it easier for people to understand the great message of the Bible. But many churches today are just not doing that. They're not making it clear that this is the way we can be saved. That's another barrier. There's the barrier of aggressive secularism. It's not just that people don't believe in God, they don't want to let us worship freely or have freedom of conscience or freedom of speech. There is the barrier of gender ideology. There are anti-Christian laws in many parts of the world. There's the barrier of persecution. There will always be barriers to the gospel because we have a great enemy who's called Satan or the devil. And it's not in his interest for people to hear the gospel so that they might believe and be saved. He doesn't want that. And so he uses all these barriers to try to stop us reaching people with the gospel. How can we overcome these barriers? Well, we need to learn from the Lord Jesus himself and how he was willing to overcome the barriers between him and that particular woman in order to share the gospel with her. We need to pray. We need to trust in the Lord to open doors. We need to be faithful to the Lord come what may. We need both wisdom and boldness, not just one or the other, but both. When we evangelize, we need to remember that we're on the front line in a spiritual war. And therefore, it is a battle. And it won't always be easy. And it will sometimes be dangerous. And it may even cost us our lives or our freedom. But that is the cost of overcoming barriers to get the gospel to people who desperately need to hear it and understand it. So we need to love people, we need to go to where they are, we need to overcome the barriers. Number four, we need to break the ice, as we would say. The Lord arrived in Sychar, wearied from his journey, we read, and he sat down beside that well. And the Samaritan woman came to the well, as Jesus knew that she would. And then something happened that to us may seem perfectly normal. But in that situation, it was not at all normal. Jesus spoke to the woman and he said to her, "Give me a drink. Give me a drink." Just four short words in English, only three short words in Greek, and I don't know how many in Aramaic. But with those few simple words, the Lord started a conversation with the woman that would lead that very day to her salvation. Before the end of that day, that woman would be a believer in Jesus, a real believer. And through her, others would come to faith in her town. But think about what Jesus did. He just spoke to the woman. He started a conversation, we might say. He didn't start with the gospel directly. He said something natural. "Give me a drink. We're at this well. I'm thirsty. You've got something to get the water out with. Please give me a drink." Just a natural conversation. He broke the ice, we might say. He connected with the woman. Do we not need to learn from Jesus in this also? Yes, we can't fulfill our mission without speaking to people because we have a message to share with them. And so we have to speak to them. But more often than not, we can't just jump in with the gospel and start directly, "Hey, can I explain to you about Jesus?" It's not always as easy as that, is it? We have to break the ice. We have to connect with people. We have to build relationships, build their trust, so that when we do come to speak to them about Jesus, they'll be open to that. We need to ask the Lord to give us the desire to evangelize, the courage, yes, the wisdom, the naturalness, the right words for the right occasions. And we see all of that happening here in those first few simple words of Jesus to the Samaritan woman, "Give me a drink, please give me a drink." So we need to love people, we need to go to where they are, we need to overcome whatever barriers are in the way, we need to break the ice. Number five, we need to get to the point. So yes, the first thing that Jesus said to the woman was, "Give me a drink." But what was the second thing that Jesus said to her? Verse 10, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." Again, Jesus packs so much theology, we might say, into that one sentence. He says that what the Samaritan woman needed was living water, spiritual water, water for the soul. And that the living water that she needed was a gift of God. He said, "The gift, you knew the gift of God." Living water isn't something we can earn by our good works or by being religious or by praying a lot. Living water, which is a way of saying salvation, is a gift of God. And Jesus told the Samaritan woman that in the second thing that he said to her. And he was saying that, If you knew the gift of God, you would have asked me. Why? Why you? Because he was God. And because he was God, he was able to give a gift of God to her. If you knew who I am, you would have asked me, and I would have given you what God gives, i.e. living water, salvation, peace with God. But she needed to ask him. He says, if you knew who I was, you would have asked me. He's teaching her that you have to ask God for the living water, not just wait for it to drop from heaven. Jesus didn't start with the gospel, but he got to the gospel pretty quickly. And he moved from the physical water to the spiritual water. Yes, we usually need to break the ice with people, but we do need to get to the point. And the point is the gospel, the good news, the great news about how people can be saved thanks to Jesus. We need to start where people are and then lead them gently to where we want to take them, which is to God, to the gospel, to the Lord Jesus himself. Sometimes that's easy, sometimes it's hard, sometimes it's almost impossible. But we haven't fulfilled our mission until we have told people the good news about how Jesus can be their saviour too. So number one, we need to love people. Number two, we need to go to them wherever they are. Number three, we need to overcome the barriers, whatever they may be. Number four, we need to break the ice. Number five, we need to get to the point. Now number six, we need to be patient with people. Just as God is so patient with us, isn't he? We need to be patient with others. Jesus was incredibly patient with the Samaritan woman. As far as she was concerned, it was all problems. Everything was a problem. She raised at least four problems. Problem number one, Jesus couldn't ask her for a drink because he was a Jewish man. She was a Samaritan woman. You know, how can you ask me for a drink? It was a problem. Second problem, where was Jesus going to get the living water from? Have you got something to get? She didn't understand that it was a spiritual water he was talking about. How can you get that living water? How can I get that? It was a problem. Number three, she couldn't call her husband because she didn't have a husband. Problem number four, they couldn't even agree about where to worship. You Jews say that it's in Jerusalem. We say it's on this mountain. Who's right? Who's wrong? It was another problem. Everything was a problem from her point of view. But do you see how patient Jesus was with her? He listened to her. He responded to what she said. He gently brought her back to the point. He didn't give up on her. If there's one thing that we need today in our sharing of the gospel with people, it is a lot of patience with the people we want to help. Because it won't always happen overnight. It won't always happen easily. We need to keep chipping away. We need to love people. We need to listen to them. We need to be patient with them, just as Jesus was with that woman on that occasion. People sometimes don't want to hear what we want to tell them. They sometimes don't listen very well. They keep changing the subject. They keep a long list of buts. But what about this? But what about that? They feel safer with their religion or with their lack of religion. And for all those and other reasons, we need to be patient. We need to ask the Lord to give us more patience with people, just as he does with us. So that was number six. Number seven, we need to talk about sin. Sin. Why did Jesus suddenly change the subject? Have you ever asked that question? Why did he say, go call your husband? Everything was going so well up until that moment. Then he says, go and call your husband. Why did Jesus say that? It almost seems unnecessary or not very helpful in the situation. Go and call your husband. He knew she didn't have a husband. He knew that she was living in sexual immorality. So why did he ask her to go and call her husband? Was it not to help her to recognize and feel her need of the gospel and her need of him, of Jesus himself? Jesus did that time and again. He told her to go and get her husband. He told the rich young ruler to sell everything he had. He told a lawyer to love his neighbor like the Good Samaritan in the parable. Why did Jesus do all of that with those people? Why did he make things so difficult for them? I'm convinced that the best explanation is that Jesus was gently helping those people to face up to their sinfulness and their desperate need of the gospel and of Jesus himself. The good news doesn't make sense without the bad news. The bad news is what makes the good news make sense. How can we understand salvation if we don't understand what we need to be saved from? The people around us, more often than not, don't believe or feel that they're in any serious danger of hell or anything like it. That's why they don't feel that they need a saviour. Me? A saviour? Why? Why do I need a saviour? Why do I need your Jesus? How can we help those people? Well, we can help them by doing what Jesus did with this woman and with others, by gently helping them to see and feel that, yes, they are sinners. They are in serious danger of being lost forever. I think this is one of the great weaknesses today of contemporary evangelicalism. We're not helping people to understand and feel their need of Jesus. And so they don't feel that they need him. We're leaving out the bad news. Obviously, it's always nicer to be telling people good news than bad news, so we avoid the bad news and jump straight to the good news, but I don't think that works. The greater the danger, the greater the sense of relief and gratitude when the danger has passed. But we must help people to see the danger and to feel the danger they're in. In a sense, the Lord could have stopped this conversation at the end of verse 14. Listen to verse 14. Whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. And we would have said, amen, stop it there, Lord. Don't continue the conversation. What a great way to present the gospel. But Jesus had to go on to say, go call your husband. He did what we seem so reluctant to do. He gently reminded the woman of the sin in her life. Call your husband. I don't have a husband. I know. I know you don't have a husband. I know all about you. He's putting his finger on something that she didn't want to talk about. She changed the subject again, straight after that. But Jesus was helping her to face up to her need of him as her saviour. And we need to tell people, yes, carefully, sensitively, lovingly, what they need to be saved from, as well as how they can be saved. So we need to love people, we need to go to where they are, we need to overcome barriers, break the ice, get to the point, be patient, talk about sin. Number 8, we need to stay focused. Here's my paraphrase of part of the conversation between the woman and Jesus. She says, how can you ask me for a drink? You need to be saved, Jesus said. In other words, are you greater than Jacob, our father, our ancestor? You need to be saved. Give me some of that water of yours. And Jesus again insisting, you need to be saved. Maybe not with those words, but with that meaning. And then she says, but what about the differences between you Jews and us Samaritans? Woman, you need to be saved. Do you see how Jesus refused to get distracted from helping her to understand her true situation before God as a sinner? And that what she most needed more than anything else was the person who was speaking to her, Jesus of Nazareth, as her saviour. Yes, we need to listen to people and to answer their honest questions, but let's not get distracted. Let's keep focused on the gospel itself, because people need to be saved. Number 9, we need to be clear. The woman said, when Messiah comes, we'll know. We'll understand things then when he comes. She knew that Messiah was coming. She knew enough of the Old Testament to know that. But then Jesus says to her, you know what? He's already come. It's me. It's me. And yet, you know, you hear people, even clever people, saying, you know, Jesus never actually claimed to be the Messiah, did he? Didn't he? He said to this woman, I who speak to you am he, the Messiah. Is that so hard to understand? Jesus was clear. He was so clear that people were often offended by what he said. That's how clear he was. They knew he was getting at them. Are we clear? Yes, we can't make people believe. We can't open their spiritual eyes. We can't make them come alive. But let's at least try to make the gospel as clear as we possibly can, so that people don't have the excuse to say, you didn't make it clear, you weren't clear in explaining to me all this about Jesus and the gospel. Number 10, and finally, the last thing that I want to mention that we need to learn from the way Jesus evangelized the Samaritan woman. We need to talk about Jesus. We need to talk about him. What did Jesus really talk to the Samaritan woman about? He talked to her about himself. He said, if you knew who I am. He said to her, I can give you living water. He said, I can give you water springing up into everlasting life. He said, I know all about your ex-husbands and the man you're living with now. He said to her, I am Messiah. Jesus was telling her who he really was. He was talking to her about himself as her Savior. And that's what we need to do, isn't it? We can talk about our church, we can talk about God in general terms, we can talk about all sorts of things that can have their place. But at the end of the day, we have to talk about Jesus, the Lord Jesus, the person of Jesus, the Savior, the Lord, the Messiah, the one that people need to be introduced to. He is the one we need to talk about, whether we're evangelizing in Spain or in Iceland or in Redditch. But our message is about a person. The church's mission, your church's mission, our mission as Christians is essentially to tell people about Jesus. So the main aim of these thoughts has been to suggest that we need to evangelize like the Master, like the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to love people as he did. We need to go to where they are. We need to overcome the barriers, break the ice, get to the point. We need to be patient with people. We need to talk about sin. We need to stay focused on the gospel. We need to be clear. And above all, we need to talk about Jesus himself. Friends, may the Lord help us all to learn from Jesus, to imitate the way he evangelized, and to honor him, the greatest evangelist of all. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we do ask you to help us, first of all, to love you and then to love the people around us. And to love them so much that what we most long to be able to do is to help them to understand the message of the gospel. To help them to understand how desperately they need the gospel. And to understand that in the Lord Jesus there is a perfect Savior able to save them. Oh Lord, help us to be faithful, to be more faithful going forward. Give us, Lord, the opportunities. Give us the right words. Give us hearts of compassion for people. Lord, in our fear and trembling, give us courage and boldness in our speaking. Lord, in other words, please help us to be more like our Savior as we seek to share the wonderful news of hope and salvation in him. Amen.
Amen.
So our closing hymn is, Go Forth and Tell, O Church of God, Awake. God's saving news to all the nations take. Proclaim Christ Jesus, Saviour, Lord and King, that all the world his worthy praise may sing. Let's stand and sing together.
Father, grant that all of us who have heard and will hear about the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might be made rich, spiritually rich with this great salvation because so great a Saviour. Grant that we may know it for ourselves and share it with others in the way that we have heard described to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I would encourage you then to remember the work of the European Mission Fellowship in your prayers, and I trust that you will have been encouraged and perhaps too challenged by the preached word today. Do join us again next week when we're expecting Gilles Boutil from Hollywood Christian Fellowship near Birmingham. God bless you.